Hello, welcome to our course, Module 3, Promoting Sector Linkages in the Resource Minerals Industry. Okay, in this module, we're going to look at how this promotion of linkages in the resource industry is very important, because currently mining in Africa is basically done by a closed industry. The mining company mines and then they export abroad. There's very little linkages between the local economy and the mining companies. So the African resource industry, it brings in large revenues, and it has also created important opportunities for economic growth and sustainable development. However, most African countries export their extractive resources as raw materials with little value added. Therefore, they have not been able to transform their resource wealth into sustainable economic development gains that benefit the rest of the economy. The value addition phase creates a lot more jobs and trebles the value chain. So currently, most African countries are losing 2/3 of the wealth that they should be getting from their minerals. Dependence on the mining sector and the risks involved. The high dependence on the extractive resources makes most of these countries vulnerable to market price fluctuations. Most African countries that have mines, they depend a lot on the income from the selling of these deposits. Underdeveloped linkages with the broader economy as a result in what we call island or capital intensive nature of the extractive industry, which leads to limited contribution, limited job creation, and limited economic diversification. Countries can respond to this challenge by moving away from exports of unrefined or semi-refined commodities to the creation of downstream industries that would spur economic development and diversification. This can be achieved by strengthening linkages of the extractive sector with the broader economy. So, examples of dependence on minerals are given here. The United Nations Committee on Trade and Development has shown that in 2016, exports of hydrocarbons and mineral commodities, mainly oil, accounted for 93% of total merchandise exports from Chad, for example, 87% from the Congo, 95% in Equatorial Guinea. These countries are heavily dependent on hydrocarbons for foreign exchange reserves. Similarly, mineral resource countries like Angola, Botswana, Ghana, Cote d'Ivoire, Mali, Mauritania, Gabon, Namibia, Niger, South Africa, Zambia, and Zimbabwe do not have very good policies on ensuring that the minerals industry is integrated with the rest of the economy. Most of them, they still sell the raw materials. South Africa is perhaps the exception. A substantial amount of the natural resources in South Africa are processed in the local economy. Okay, but more countries should do more with the processing of the local materials. The risks of high dependence on mining alone are very high, because the extractive resources makes these countries vulnerable to market price fluctuations. When the market price goes up, they are very all right. When the market price goes down, they lose a lot of revenue. These underdeveloped linkages with the broader economy as a result of the enclave type or capital intensive nature of the extractive sector leads to the sector's limited contribution to job creation and economic diversification. The mining sector, if it was purposely designed to integrate local players in the value chain, it would add value. Okay, good examples of countries that have put policies are China, India. These countries ensure that they add value to their raw materials. Countries can respond to this challenge by moving away from exports of unrefined or semi-refined commodities to the creation of downstream industries that would spur economic development and diversification. So what is required is that we need special policies that should actually help us to transform our economies from mining only and mining and processed material to mining and adding value. Let's look at a case study for Chad, for example. In 2003, agriculture accounted for 42% of GDP for Chad, compared to 14% for oil. In 2004, the oil exploitation had been the main source for revenue and economic activity. In 2015, Chad exported 1.2 billion CFA francs of oil, 92.8 billion CFA francs of livestock, and 53.7 CFA francs of cotton, representing 58%. Okay, so the commodity price falls had an effect on mineral and crude oil-based economies. The example of oil price slump in 2014 had a severe impact on the economy of Chad. Okay, and what this meant is that it eroded the country's source of revenue from the crude oil. Chad has no downstream and very little upstream industries associated with crude oil. Thus, at least if Chad could build a refinery, they would have processed oil products and the chemicals from the crude oil, which are very much used in the pharmaceutical industries. Jobs would have been created and value would have been added. There is no diversified economy, okay? Which means that if the economy falls into recession, the whole budget collapses. This is what makes these countries so vulnerable to external debt. They go to the IMF to seek for new bilateral agreements so that they can improve their budgetary requirements. Another case, it's Congo. Oil exploitation in the Congo began in 1960, and between 1975 and 1984, it was transforming the structure of the Congolese economy. In 2015, petroleum accounted for 85% of the total exports. Oil timber was only 3.6. In spite of ongoing efforts to diversify the economy, the Congolese economy has remained dependent on oil. According to the Economist Intelligence Unit, oil represented 40% of GDP, 70% of foreign export receipts, more than 40% of fiscal revenue. This is too big to value. High dependence on oil makes the Congo vulnerable to market oil price changes. Okay. In 2012 and 2016, oil production contracted by 14% because of the falling oil prices. Okay, and what this did to the Congolese economy is that the Congolese economy did not grow as it was predicted to grow. Okay, sectors such as manufacturing, electricity, and gas and telecommunications were the ones that helped the country to grow economically. Without that diversification, a drop of 60% in foreign revenues would have plunged the country into recession. What still lacks in the Congo is the integration of the oil industry with the domestic industry. That means they need to build refineries so that they can refine their own oil. The decline in oil prices from 2014-2016 resulted in a reduction in revenues of 54%. That's almost more than half the budget of the country. Okay, the World Bank forecasts recovery in GDP growth at an average of 3.6% between 2017 and 2019. Okay, so this will be mostly driven by the oil field which was discovered. Socioeconomic indicators in the Congo improved between 2004 and 2011 during the oil boom. In addition, between 2010 and 2013, public investments also increased by 300%. What has to be done now in the Congo is to actually build refineries so that they can add value and create jobs locally. Let's look at Equatorial Guinea. In 2015, hydrocarbons accounted for 60% of GDP, 80% of fiscal revenue, 86% of exports. That's a very high value on one commodity. By contrast, non-oil sectors contribute only very small to the economy. Dependence on exports of hydrocarbons leaves the country vulnerable. Okay? Despite government efforts to diversify this economy of the Equatorial Guinea, it still remains dependent on oil. GDP declined 8.3% when there was an oil price drop. And GDP growth is projected to contract to an average rate of 6% over the next few years, between 2016 and 2018. That was the World Bank prediction. Okay. So, from these three case studies, what we can see is that there is need to develop linkages. Okay, the narrow focus on exports of raw commodities to industrialized countries comes at the expense of national development. Raw commodities are often not processed, okay, into high value products. And this, of course, it means that the locals do not get enough jobs and the communities lose out. To mitigate price volatility, governments need to build and strengthen linkages between the extractive sector and the rest of the economy. This will help to overcome the enclaves that often form around extractive projects and force economic diversification. In the case of oil, for example, you need a refinery. And from a refinery, you can have now the chemicals industries also taking the products coming from the refinery in the pharmaceutical industry and, of course, in the motor industries. Okay. Diversification is the key. In this context, governments in resource-rich countries need to put in place measures, deliberate measures, to create and strengthen development linkages, okay? So that these special linkages can combine the local economy with the minerals economy as one. These linkages should be interrelated. For example, strengthening the fiscal regime can raise the funds necessary for infrastructure investment, thus creating special linkages necessary to attract domestic investment in the upstream sector and also attracting FDI from outside. They need to put in policies that can directly access their raw materials and transform them into high-value products. For example, Rwanda is making cell phones using the columbide from their own country. They do not sell it as a raw product, so they use it to produce cell phones. That's a very good example. Forward production linkages involve processing of commodities extracted by the industry locally to produce finished products instead of exporting them in their raw state. This can contribute to retaining more wealth in the country as well as promoting employment and also industrialization and technological advancement. Backward production linkages connect local suppliers of goods and services to extractive companies. For example, in case of Rwanda, when the cell phones are made, then you have other companies that can market these cell phones in the country and outside the country. This can bring significant social and economic benefits with multiplier effects of wages, revenue spent locally, thereby providing a further boost to the economy. So these linkages are the right way to develop these economies. Fiscal linkages also allow for the collection and strategic use of resource risk. So companies that work in these countries, then the money they pay as taxes can be directed towards development of strengthening the linkages and not just in other sectors. For example, revenues obtained from the sale of hydrocarbons and mineral commodities and from taxes and royalties can now be used in promotion of industrial development and commodity sectors. Special linkages can involve building essential infrastructure to facilitate resource extraction. Strategic investments by extractive companies or host government in the infrastructure such as electricity generation, roads, rail, ports, can lead to benefits in other economic sectors. For example, investment in roads can improve the functioning of local markets. And so these linkages should be allowed to tie the market and tie the country's economic sector as one. Consumption linkages will also entail spending the income generated from extractive industry on goods and services produced by other sectors within the economy. Demand created from rising incomes of workers can also be spent on the sector and can contribute to the development of new industries and employment. Horizontal linkages, these involve the skills and capabilities acquired in the extractive sector to develop other industry activities or sectors. So government support through the creation of business-friendly environment, for example, can foster development of small and medium enterprises and contribute to industrialization and job creation. Okay, and then we can also now see how diversification can work. It can only work if the local content policies are enacted. Local content policies. So within the context of the extractive sector, local content requirements contain obligations to employ local service providers and workers in specific sectors, as well as the purchase of locally produced goods like machinery and other hardware. Requirements on contracting local labor should comply with commitments of member states of the World Trade Organization. Okay, so that is a necessity that they should also comply with WTO regulations. What are the challenges involved in developing these linkages? The first one is access to finance for small scale, mid and medium enterprises. Okay, so the access to finance, okay, makes these enterprises not to be able to move forward. And therefore, the extractive sector can underscore that limited access to affordable finance constraint such that their participation in the extractive industry can be significant. What does that mean? What that means is that local mining companies must try and involve SMEs as partners in development. The lack of skills in SMEs and other local enterprises in the project countries, and the lack of technical and managerial skills to capitalize on backward and forward production linkages is another challenge. Limited institutional capacity is another challenge, especially as related to the implementation of laws and regulation. This contributes to the slow development and slow participation of local enterprises in the sector. And then the lack of civil society involvement. Civil society must be involved because it helps to promote transparency. It helps to promote transparency and sustainable development. Okay. Challenges are continued here. One of the challenges is the lack of infrastructure. So the lack of adequate infrastructure, such as electricity, roads, water, has contributed to the limited participation of SMEs. Insufficient information flow, poor information flow, also limits opportunities related to local content negatively. And it affects both multinational and contracting companies, and potential and local contractors. Capacity to maximize interest in contract negotiations. Often government enter into agreements that favor extractive companies rather than local communities. Okay, so that is another expertise which is lacking, which is contract negotiations. Regional collaboration is also an important thing. Okay, sharing experiences at regional level can lead to the design of frameworks that are more appropriate into a country's context. Countries can share the production cycles to mutually benefit them. They can implement policies that remove trade barriers to accelerate trade and economic growth. Countries can also establish a coordination mechanism that can efficiently engage the different ministries and agencies involved in local content development. Local content development has to happen if linkages have to occur. We also need to deepen government reforms and policy generation. These policies, okay, they need to be initiated both in countries and also in companies to improve how institutions deal with issues such as the promotion of local private companies and skills development. Whether or not these institutions receive a share of the budget that would enable them to implement these new activities. Local content is an important part in creating linkages. The creation of mining development funds. Very few countries have these mining development funds. These, they establish collateral funds supported by transnationals and governments to facilitate the access of SMEs. That means big mining companies and government can facilitate the formation of these funds, and these would help SMEs to get involved. This could contribute to boosting competitiveness and productivity. While some efforts have already been made to help SMEs gain access to the banking sector, these efforts need to be scaled up with innovative policies such as facilitation of electronic currency, mobile money, objective of improving economic transactions, and reducing the impact of potential corruption that may arise from handling of too much cash by stakeholders. Okay. The scaling up of training programs that emphasize practical skills. So practical skills are an important part if we have to create linkages between the mining sector and the SMEs. There are limited training programs which are targeted at local SMEs, especially on issues such as health, environment, and quality management. Training programs need to expand to include coaching SMEs on engaging in industrial, financial, and commercial partnership with multinational companies involved in mining. Training programs to continuously improve their skills and also to create capacity in contract negotiations. That is a very important aspect, because contract negotiations is the part that ensures that you can create good agreements that allow local content to be increased. Okay, thank you very much. That's the end of our lecture.